introduce Rachel Semrose, and I have a copy of Rachel's book, Stand By Your Nan. It's so moving and so good, I've read it twice. Second time today on the way up here on the train. And so Rachel's poems are about her relationship with her grandmother, who was a painter, and somebody made cakes and did all sorts of other things in her life. But they're wonderful poems. It's a really thoroughly realised collection in my view. So these are on sale. Rachel also wants you to know that she's starting a regular event in Sutton, which is at Sutton Library. The first one, which is a taster session, on the 26th of May. So there'll be featured poets, there'll be open mic spaces there. So if you want more information about that, ask Rachel. Sutton Library, for those of you who know it, has long been regarded as a model for good librarianship. So it's a good place to get to if you can. But what we really want to do now is hear from Rachel Semrose. Welcome, Rachel.
Thank you very much. I thought, because I've got two sections, I thought for this first section I would do poems from the book so that you get a flavour of my nan. It's always difficult to kind of introduce yourself, especially when you're doing poetry and things, but I was there. For my sins, I was a contestant on The Chase, and it was about last week. I failed really badly at The Chase, but I kind of enjoyed the fact I was on TV. And when you're on I haven't watched it myself either, but Twitter always kind of makes little comments about you and things like that. So I had quite a lot of, not that many actually, to be fair, but I got the best ever introduction, and that was, she looks like Lorraine Kelly without any money. And I thought, that's quite accurate actually. I'm trying to be less the nice lady, but I probably am. Yeah. Anyway, so yeah, this is a collection. It's kind of come about bizarrely by accident because I did I've been funded by the Arts Council England to do a tour of a spoken word show. So I've spent the past kind of few months going round to different community centres and libraries. I do love doing stuff in libraries, and meeting people and giving them a platform for their stories about their nans as well. And during this process, I was writing a lot of poems about my nan, and they, as I started to do them, people started to say, we want more poems. So that was nice. I feel like an accidental poet is what I'm trying to say. And everything I write kind of comes out of personal experience, and I'm not a landscape poet, if that's what I mean. So, my grandmother was an ordinary woman. She was a Brummie, and her first memory, listening to what you were saying, her first memory was of being a three-year-old thief, because she was sent out in World War I to go and find coal, and her mother kicked her and her brother Eric out. He was five and she was three, and they had to wander around the streets and try and find coal. And she used to say, oh, I don't know where she expected us to find it, neighbours coal hole. Thinking about that now, it's amazing how your grandmother becomes history. And we kind of look to books for history, and I always think, well, actually, you could just look to your own personal history to see what's changed in the world. She wanted to do a lot of things in her life, and she wasn't really allowed. So she used to keep a lot of it secret. But the one ambition she had, apart from wanting to be a musical star and wanting to be an artist, and wanting to be a yogi as well. She was very into her spiritual pursuits. She really wanted to be a bus conductor, a clippy on the buses. But when World War II came around and they announced that she could possibly be doing a man's job, she wasn't allowed because she was pregnant. Aww. So this is my kind of ode to her, which is clippy on the buses. So in the Birmingham accent, bus is always pronounced buzz, and a conductor was called a Clippy. I want to be a Clippy on the buses. That's the job for me. Nothing better than clipping the tickets, checking them on and chucking the naughty boys off. Taking charge of the bus, going all over the shop, all over with my clipping machine on my hip. Clip, clip, clip. Smiling at strangers that will soon be friends, taking their coppers as they ting to stop, and I hang at the front chatting to driver. We do have a laugh, we do, in my smart, smart uniform all bristling and clean. I watch the Clippy on the bus as a passenger. He comes over with his balanced ability to navigate the aisles like a panther or a circus tightrope walker. He knows what to do, no messing about, just clippity clip clip clip. I smile and I thank him as he clips my ticket. He smells of old man and tobacco, and I think to myself, that could be me. I could do that. I could be a Clippy on the bus. She was a working class Brummie, as I said, but I was brought up in a kind of middle class, my dad made goods and all that, so I used to find it quite embarrassing sometimes, some of her turns of phrases, as you do when you're a kid and you're around older people. And I see it myself now with my teenage daughter takes the piss out of me all the time for my accent. She doesn't have one. So this is about that. It's called Put Your Leg in Bed. Put your leg in bed, she said. Put your leg in bed. Top deck of the bus was scary. I'd never been on a bus to town. Only ever stayed downstairs near the door. But put your leg in bed, she said. Put your leg in bed. I didn't know what she meant and frowned. She made a triangle with her arm at the elbow and gestured. Put your arm in there, she said. Put your leg in bed. So embarrassed I was, but I did slip my arm through hers. Worried that others would see and hear the accent, though we all had it. Embarrassed at ancient phrasing, like any road up. And a nice bit of meat. Put your leg in bed, she said. Put your leg in bed. Got off at the Bullring Market so she could buy her fish and veg. Hagglers shouting, a self-conscious attack on my nose by fish guts. Unlike the sea, more like scraping the bottom of an ice cream bin. Put your leg in bed, she said. Put your leg in bed. No cars in a car park, no air-conditioned, clean-lined supermarket. And we walked around, me, a child scared and out of place. Put your leg in bed, she said. Put your leg in bed. Safe, arm in arm, I did. It's another buzz poem, I might as well do the other buzz poem. She had a scar on her face, and I asked her how she got it, and this is the story of that. It's called Running for a Buzz. Can't miss the buzz, but takes too long walking, yawning, stretch of pavement, past the house where Olive lived, her friend with the heat in her hands. A number 101, that held a young couple who argued in the streets, and the community centre for street parties, Christmas dances, Jubilee. Her feet troubled the pavement, dashing faster, skipping over dislodged paving stones into the bottom, turning past the small run of small shops, but the buzz is already there, she'd never make it. Picked up her pace, running out of time, out of breath, holding her hat with one hand, in the other the shopping trolley bag, dragging behind her with bumps and bounces. roadworks force a stench of hot air filling her nostrils. She clenches them but carries on, the buzz her object of desire. Must catch it or wait too long in the cold, hitting bones through to the marrow, banging feet onto pavement. Eyes on, brain set in motion, ignored her feet. Tripped up, one betraying toe caught on. An upturned tectonic fault of paving sends her flying onto hot tar, searing the skin of her chin, holding it together, making a scar that would forever be, in my mind, part of her face. Beautiful. In her mind, the scar of rash decisions, of running when you shouldn't run, shouldn't climb, shouldn't be beautiful. I've got a couple of poems in this that are kind of about being a woman that she was an older woman who was oppressed, basically. She didn't get to do what she wanted to do, and I think this one, if you can, this one is actually, I saw in Shed World. they had in the garden centre, they have a shed world, and I love shed worlds because I imagine what my shed would be. And they had a massive shed and they turned it into a man shed. And then in some of the other ones, they dressed them, and in one of them, they dressed it with a mannequin in a tabard and an ironing board because that was the woman's shed. So I've gone back and said, to be fair, they have changed the man shed into a Prosecco shed to even it up a bit, but the ironing board lady's still there. So this kind of reminds me of her as well, because she was always in the kitchen. It's called In Shed World. In the man cave is a porter cabin of testosterone, glorious MDF bar, chemical toilet, cinema. In the woman's shed is a mannequin wearing a flowery tabard, no chair, staring straight ahead, doing the ironing, bored. No one told Virginia Woolf. Her kitchen staff wanted rooms of their own, with doors that shut, and the mannequin wants a writer's hut. Mm. Hey. I don't know what I'm doing for time here, so you have to wave at me, but I've got a couple more. Okay, I'll just do it. It's difficult to explain what it was about my nan that kind of inspired me so much. I think she was somebody who kept a lot of things back, and so in front of everybody else she would be like an ordinary working class woman, but behind closed doors she was a painter. And she painted from the age of 60 till she died at 98. And she was a spiritual quester, really. She tried everything. She went to Quakers. She went to trying to Zen Buddhism. She taught herself yoga when they didn't have yoga. And she did all these things, and she used to keep it very quiet. So there was something about the arc of her life, which to me was really important, about kind of always being in the eternal present moment, I suppose. But when she died, I found the reaction really hard because I really missed her. And I was kind of told not to mourn. So this is called Better You Should Forget and Smile, which is a famous poem. I am sad at her passing. My mother tells the minister to have a word with me, as I am likely to show emotion. oh no, don't do that, never show it, don't be a fuss. We need to be happy and believe she's with Jesus now. We can't miss an old lady. We can't see them as meaningful. Just let the light fade out and be blessed she was old and had her good innings, even though she never played cricket. Old means she was lucky, didn't die in war or famine or childbirth. She survived a century, and for that you must be glad and quip about her length of life. But don't you see, a life can be missed, even if it is long, because in the present moment, she's gone. Mm.
Yeah.
Mm. I'll do this last one, because it's the one that people like.
Like them all.
But it's called, the first one that I wrote, and it is because she didn't leave me anything specifically, but she did leave cigar boxes with kind of pastels and paints in them. And in one of the cigar boxes was cassette tapes. And what she'd done is she'd recorded lectures from people and pressed the button at the same time. So in the background, I could kind of hear stuff. And this is about that. It's about that moment of hearing something. It's called By Heart. I memorised your face or wrinkles or lines, but they faded like the sound of your voice. You left tapes, but on them are lectures by others you'd listen to, not your voice. The only sound of you is footsteps in the background as you change the tapes, as you walked across the room to turn it over in the ways we did back then. The sound of slow, sure steps across the room. I know it was the back room and you were sat in your armchair next to the glass cabinet of ornaments you weren't allowed to touch, glasses and plates. Never use the nice stuff, it's just for show. And behind you was the window to the garden that you tended all weathers till nearly a century old. And I can see you listening to the tape and realising one side had reached its end. You stood and walked over to the recorder. I hear the sound of the lecturer, but all I have of you is footsteps. Why didn't you just say hello? Did you not know one day I'd be desperate to hear it again? 4700, the number of your phone. You said that when you picked it up. 4700, I hear them in my head, I remember. But still, what I wouldn't give for you to have recorded yourself reciting poetry or saying hello one more time. But you stayed quiet, not feeling important enough or public enough to record it. And all I have is footsteps and the memory of a number off by heart. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much, Rachel. And I think we've probably all felt Rachel's grandmother was in the room. Fantastic.